Hello, this is Bobby Groh again. I'm going to do another podcast here. I'm not quite sure what I want to call my podcast. I did have another, I guess, iteration of this podcast maybe a year ago, I guess, now. I call that just simply the Evangelical Calvinist Podcast. But I'm still trying to think of a name for this new iteration of my podcasting life, which is an interesting thing. I mean, I'm not sure how to develop it exactly, but I'll just sit here and talk and see how that goes. But so as soon as I come up with a name, I'll let you know. But in this podcast, I want to talk about just some of my influences and kind of where I started out theologically and ecclesially in the church. What my, so to speak, family of origin is theologically and ecclesiologically. And talk about how that origin informs and has informed the way that I have been developing, have developed to where I'm at currently. So, and I kind of came up with this idea just because I listened to a new podcast by a guy named Anthony Wick and his friend Nick. And then I think they're going to have another guy, another friend of theirs named Yoon, joining them eventually. But they just started a new podcast called the Post-Reformed Podcast. And so, but of course, so in their first podcast, they're just basically introducing themselves and talking about what I'm going to talk about in my podcast. And so that's where my idea came from for this podcast. If any of you have read my blog for any amount of time, none of this will probably be surprising to you. I'm pretty much an open book as far as, I'm pretty transparent as far as my, the way that I communicate communicate through my blog and on Facebook. So, but anyway, I still think maybe it will be interesting for some of you to hear some of my background and how that informs and shapes my conclusions and where I have arrived at currently as I continue to develop, continue to learn, continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so, let me just start out from the beginning, really, of my life. I came to Christ at an early age. I was 3 years old, and I was born into the house of a Baptist pastor, conservative Baptist pastor. And my parents both love the Lord, both love Jesus. And, you know, when I was three, I mean, I was exposed to the gospel in the womb. When I was 3 years old, I woke up one night and just felt like I wanted to accept Christ into my life. My parents made sure I understood. I went and woke them up. They made sure I understood what that, you know, entailed as simply as I could understand that. And I did. And I accepted Christ. And I began my walk with Jesus when I was 3 years old. And so, and then I just continued to grow. Continued to attend church. Was involved in the ministry with my dad. He'd take me door to door when that was the thing, and do bus ministry and visitation ministry. So that was my growing up. I'm just going to snapshot certain periods of my life to get to what I really want to talk to you about, which is just my theological informers of today and how I got to where I am today. So anyway, I continued to grow to age. Graduated high school in 1992 from Brethren Christian High School. At that point, they were in Cypress, California, which is in Orange County on the border of LA County. And the Lord got a hold of me through some really trying circumstances. I won't go into those details. And he introduced, I will say he introduced some crises into my life, some serious crises. And through those, he really began to discipline me and disciple me. And really, that's the point where I made a strong commitment to reading scripture. Ironically, I was listening to James Dobson, and which I don't do anymore. But the Lord used that nevertheless at that point. And James Dobson, as I was listening to the program, was interviewing a guy, and this guy just mentioned how his grandpa had been reading through his Bible his whole life. And when he died, this guy found it at his house, his Bible, and he would, he'd keep all the dates of when he'd start, when he'd finish each time through the Bible. So I actually started doing that myself in 95, and by God's grace, I continue to do that and read through the Bible that way two or three times a year since then. And the Lord began to use his word in my life by being saturated in it that way, in ways that are it's hard to describe, really, what he's done through that in my life. And I know many of you know that as well, as you've pushed into God's word and encountered Jesus Christ there. You've seen the transformative power of God as you encounter the living word in Jesus Christ. And so the Lord used that in my life. That was back in 1995. And I continue to go through the crises. I'm not going to talk about what those were right now. But he continued to use those. I will say I struggled heavily with doubt. That wasn't the only thing. That only really exacerbated the other issues I was dealing with. Lots of anxiety, lots of depression, and doubt. Doubting God's existence intellectually. And so it was tormentuous for me. I had really nowhere to turn. I had no real intellectual resources available to me. I mean, my background was pretty much fundamentalist, even jelly belly type pietistic theology. And so it made it hard. I mean, my resources were Harry Ironside, J. Vernon McGee, and then I got hooked up at that point with Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa, and the fellowship was good for me. I went to their Bible college for a year, 96, 97, but there still was no intellectual rigor, no real answers for me. And so I was just afloat in real existential crisis and many dark nights of the soul. It wasn't just dark nights, it was dark seasons of the soul during that season of time, those seasons of time, which covered years. And so I did go to that Calvary Chapel Bible College, 96, 97. And I had good fellowship there. But like I said, I just wasn't being fed what I needed. And I wasn't being formed in the way that I needed at that point. So at that time, in 98, I started at Multnomah Bible College, which is in Portland, Oregon. And it did have the kind of intellectual rigor. My professors were PhDs in theology and biblical studies, and so they had that critical scholarship that my mind really needed, just spiritually. It wasn't an academic thing, it was a spiritual thing for me. And actually, I don't even make that dichotomy between academia and spirituality per se. I don't think it's unnecessary. I can see why that needs to be made, but I don't want to digress here, so let's move on. So anyways, I was at Multnomah Bible College. I finished in 90, graduated in 2001 with a double major in biblical studies and theology and a minor in Koine Greek, and then I enrolled at Multnomah Biblical Seminary, same campus. And I did an MA in biblical studies theology, which was an academic degree, and I pretty much majored, I guess you could say, at that level in historical theology and New Testament studies. And I did my master's thesis was an exegetical analysis of 1 Corinthians 1, 17 through 25. So I finished that in 2003. And then I graduated. And So, I was hoping to get in a ministry, pastoral ministry. And those doors closed, it seemed, for me at that time. And so, I'm not going to give you the whole history of my life, employment-wise, after seminary. I'll just say I was underemployed, unemployed, and ended up in certain industries and jobs that I never would have imagined when I was going to Bible college and seminary. And currently, I work for the railroad, which I'm praying, hopefully, my way out of. But during all that time now, since 2003 through now, I was set up very well by particularly Ron Frost and Paul Metzger in seminary. And they gave me a good trajectory and good resources to be where I'm at right now. And so I've just continued to study, continue to read, write, and it's been quite the ride. I've abandoned a lot of doctrines that I never could have imagined when I was an undergrad or years prior to that. I've abandoned dispensationalism as my hermeneutic. I've identified as Reformed, which I never would have even during seminary, even though that's kind of what I was getting theologically. And just the way that I view scripture, I was a hardcore inerrantist. I was just an evangelical. And so, yeah, I guess you could say I'm a Bartian in quotes in some ways. That's kind of relative based upon who you're comparing me to. But yeah, I would say I'm probably Bartian-esque, Bartian, Torrentian. Thomas Torrance and Bart have transformed my whole life theologically. So now I'm just kind of hinting at what has informed my life theologically. So since I only have 15 minutes on this free podcasting app, I'm running out of time right now. So let this podcast just be like a ground clearing podcast, kind of a very introductory look into my life and kind of where I've come from in a very general, quick way. And I'm going to do another podcast right after this. I'll share them both together. And I want to get further into what, materially, what theologians have shaped me. And I'm going to go back to when I started Bible college. I actually went to Bible college, I forgot to mention this, my first time, for one semester, to Southwestern Bible College in Phoenix, Arizona, which was a conservative Baptist Bible college. It's now become a liberal arts college. It's called Arizona Christian University. But so I didn't share that. So I'm gonna, because I wanna, I just said that because I'm gonna go back to that point and kind of start into talking about who I was introduced to first, as the theologians I should listen to, and kind of work my way to where I am now. So let's just end this one now, and then I'll start my next 15 minutes in a new podcast. So hopefully even this has been interesting to you, as interesting as my life might be. And we'll just I'll catch you on that next in the next podcast, and we'll get further into what has influenced me most theologically. So I look forward to seeing you there. I hope you'll meet me there. Blessings.